Fairhaven Church started in 1881, and it was founded by a man named Robert Perry. He was a Welsh coal miner and lived in what was then called Fairhaven, which was a very, very small village on top of Fairhaven Coal Mine, which was owned by Jacob and Milton Hayes. Milton Hayes was a legislator for Pennsylvania, and Jacob Hayes was his father. Jacob Street was named after Jacob Hayes. And but Robert Perry came to a revivalist meeting in 1881, August of 1881, in Castle Shannon at the Christian meeting grounds. And that was 10 acres of land. Wealthier people would buy land and build houses on their section of land. Each unit of land cost $250. And some of the original members of the church, William Troth and Edwin Bennett, owned houses there. And for those who weren't wealthy enough to do that, every Sunday was a revivalist meeting, and they would bring famous speakers to speak about causes that were of paramount importance to Methodists. The original church building is this building right here, not the addition, which was built in 2001. Originally, there were two steps going down from the front door, and the front yard went out to the dark line of that asphalt repair right there. And the city required, demanded that they buy land from the church to, widen Sawmill Run Boulevard. When the church was built, it was, this was a dirt road, and it was called the Township Road. It's a dirt path. But as Overbrook was absorbed by Pittsburgh in 1929, and in 1931, they wanted more land to widen the road. So it's been creeping in on us for a long time. And they also, in 29, they rerouted Sawmill Run Creek. The creek was much closer, and they shifted it, and it now runs under the road this way, right near the intersection of Glenberry and Sawmill Run. The creek comes down, and it goes under the road and then along here. But we have pictures of flash floods from 2 years ago, just the water just racing towards the church. Originally, the door had pile asters on either side, and all of the windows had pediments to them. In 1957, the church was originally wood, and it was just too costly to maintain. So painting it like every 10 years, so the aluminum sided it. And when they did that, they took away all the pediments and the pile asters. There was also, right under this eave, and right here on the tower, and on the other side of the tower, there were circular quatrefoil windows, which were also aluminum siding was put over them. The original frames are in the bell tower, and the glass was deliberately broken. We have shards of it. The cupola is not original either. The original cupola was taken down in 1957 for structural issues, and this was put back on in 1991. The original roof was slate, and that was also taken down in 1939 when the church was condemned, and we can talk more about that inside. The original Fairhaven Church only really had three rooms. This main room here, which was the social hall. And if you look into historic documents about old churches, especially Methodist churches, you'll see that members of the church are differentiated from members of the Sunday school. This is where the Sunday school met. And Fairhaven's Sunday school, like a lot of Methodist Sunday schools, was of critical importance in the teaching of literacy to the people of the village. Approximately in 1880, the literacy level among children was less than 15%. But by coming here and doing Bible studies and actually teaching literacy, by 1900, we see the increase in literacy to over 80%. This church, the congregation, the people of the church, had a great deal of impact and influence on the folks in this area by increasing literacy levels dramatically from the founding of the church in 1881 until the 1900 census, when we're able to actually document the literacy level of the residents of the community. Robert Perry lived on Briggs Street, which is on the little mountain across from the church and sits on top of the Fairhaven coal mine. And his next door neighbor was a woman named Hannah Hibbs. And he approached her for help. The first issue they needed to deal with was where to meet. And the original place that they met was the Baldwin Township School, which was about two blocks down from here. And it was on the corner of Sawmill Run and Maytide. The building burnt down in 1907. And the congregation met there. It did not have a formal pastor until 1883. So for the first 2 years, a guy named Brother Bennett would walk down from Brownsville Road to do Sunday school and do a service, Sunday service. Brother Bennett was a very wealthy florist and one of five Bennett children who were very impactful here at the church. In 1890, Baldwin Township decided to evict the church from its school building and having services there. That is when Hannah Hibbs approached Mr. John Thompson to donate some land on Glenberry Street. And right across the street is Glenberry, and it was called Fairhaven Road then. And you go under the train trestle, and immediately after you pass the street on the left-hand side, there's a, no one's quite sure where the church was, but this is my belief. Right there on the left-hand side, there was a wooden building built. And Thompson donated the property. He owned the granite mine, which was right across the street. The church met there from 1890 until 1907, when this building was built. And the reason that this building was built was the membership was just outstripping the space that the building had to offer. But the building, it was very traditional, a square house. Mr. Provost of Provost Lumber donated all of the wood, and the congregation built it. And even the young ladies who belonged to the church hammered the nails into the walls. We have a picture of the inside of one room of that church. Once again, very, very stark. Not much decoration. They had a pump organ, which was actually when the church was evicted from the Baldwin Township School District, Mr. Perry had to carry the pump organ all the way from the Baldwin Township School up to his house on Bridge Street, which would be, it's a very steep hill, and I can imagine very exhausting. When this building opened in 1907, the pump organ was still here until the 40s, and then it was replaced. So when the church congregation outgrew Glenberry street location, Hannah Hibbs once again looked for someone to donate land. And one of the wealthier families around here was the Horning family. And people who are familiar in the South Hills might recognize the name. A little community named Horning is located nearby, and there were several Horning coal mines. And the Horning family owned all the property on this side of Sawmill Run and going back at least 4 to 5 miles, okay, a lot of land. This piece of land actually, Mrs. Horning, her name was Cordelia Long Horning, her maiden name was Long, she bought this land from Andrew Mellon in 1867 for $12,000. The Hornings donated the land. They had a nice, beautiful St. Anne's architectural house a block down, and which has been torn down now, but they lived very close. And the Horning family continued to have a major influence, this church's history and its congregation. This church cost about $7,000 to build. The windows were about $3,000, and all of the windows were donated by the Horning family. And Mrs. Horning also bought the church bell. And later on, we'll show you the bell tower room, which is in pretty bad shape, and we're hoping to redo that. The bell was a timepiece for the Fairhaven community. It was rung twice a day at 8:45 and 10:15 p.m., 8:45 a.m. The important thing to remember is this church was the middle of everything. It was the biggest building, the most expensive building. It was dedicated on December 7th, 1907, and my grandmother was here, and they were giving away souvenirs as a glass paperweight with a picture of the church, and the minister at that time was Reverend Sanders, and I still have that, and it's an amazing artifact to still have, and it's going to be in the church archives. In 1881, on the original membership dockets, there was 10 people. Surprisingly, Robert Perry is not one of those people, but certainly he was a member of the Sunday School. And the memberships of those two were very different and unique. We see in 1890, the church membership is being 51, but the Sunday School attendance, or the members of the Sunday School, were over 90. So, the Sunday School, its primary goal was, it's a socialization thing, but also it was about literacy and teaching people how to read. In 1880, the population of the village of Fairhaven was about 364 people. That includes children. Only four of the head of households work in any field other than mining. Everybody else is a miner. There was a grocer, a dairy, a dairy owner, and a farmer. And other than that, everybody was a coal miner. Jacob Hayes, he developed the village of Fairhaven in 1871, and he encouraged people to come out here to live where they worked. And each plot of land was sold for generally about $50. He was in cooperation with John Briggs. Mr. Briggs owned most of the land, but in an interesting switch, Mr. Hayes bought all of the mineral rights under the land. So together they really sort of controlled the whole area. And when any of the miners came in to buy the property, the person who guaranteed their mortgage was Mr. Hayes. And he built a railroad out here to take care of getting his coal from here to the south side of Monongahela River. He developed a railroad, the Pittsburgh and Castle Shannon Railroad. He was president of that for many years. Whenever the railroad went into receivership in 1881, all of the people who had mortgages with Mr. Hayes were evicted, and his property, all that property was liquidated. So it was a huge upheaval of residents then because of that. And some of them were able to buy their property back. Some were not able to and had moved on. This village was one of extreme poverty. And people say that, and it's become so typical that it doesn't even make an impact. But I do mean poverty. Little boys began working in the mines at the age of 4 or 5, and because they could get into little narrow spaces that men couldn't do, they could pick up coal and put it into buckets. The average wage of a Fairhaven coal miner was about $300 a year. And if you look at our membership financial records for the few years that we have them back then, there were people giving as much as 10 cents a week, 10 cents a week for the maintenance of the church. And Methodists generally favor a tithing program, like giving 10% of your wages to the church. And in some cases, the 10% they gave not the 10%. The amount they gave was well exceeded 10%. And if kids couldn't work in the mines yet, what they would do is they would wait along the Pittsburgh and Castle Shannon railroad tracks and wait for the coal mine cars to go by on their way to the Monongahela River and wait for the coal to fall off, and they would grab the coal and take it home to their moms. So in a dramatic bit of irony, the miners couldn't afford to buy the coal they mined. That simple. The place was also very unsanitary. There's no groundwater in Fairhaven. It's above a mine. So any kind of water that was used had to be brought from Samuel Run, carried up the hill. A couple more sophisticated homes there had a cistern where they would collect rainwater and it would go into a well behind their house. Most of the houses on Fairhaven, there's a few homes that predate this building. Converted barns, converted stables, and with people with huge families. and a lot of water-based diseases killed villagers. There was a smallpox epidemic in 1893 where they quarantined the corner of Selma Run in 88. They quarantined all the victims. And in 1880, there was a cholera epidemic which killed it killed generally the children, probably killed at least 20% of the children under the age of 10 in Fairhaven. One of Mr. Perry's, Mr. Perry's son died at the age of 2.5. Diphtheria, very common. Cholera, diphtheria, dysentery, I mean, it was a lot of very bad diseases that today we don't even think about. There was no electricity. Fairhaven wasn't made electric until 1919. In 1929, gas was introduced. And then 1930s, electric. This church was not wired for electric originally, obviously. It had fire, it had a wood accelerator for coal stoves, and I'll show you where they were placed. My point is that people here were very, very poor. We see Mr. Horning donating $50 a week, $50 a month rather, to Fairhaven. And as a fifth generation member, I was able to find my my aunt, great aunt, who was, she donated 3 cents a week. She had four children to feed, and her husband was a stable master for Mr. Briggs. And so the amount of sacrifice, at least I feel the amount of sacrifice that the people in this church gave for the church is stupefying in some ways, because the poverty was so rampant. When your family worked there, and of course the sons, as I said earlier, started working there at the age of 5, one of my dad's cousins said they worked from dark to dark. It was dark in the morning when they went to work, and it was dark when they came home from work. Many communities around here, little town of Horning, Coal Center, Castle Shannon, all grew up, all developed along with mines. That was the industry, and that was the industry that made this area really important. And so the argument was made that this development, this neighborhood development pattern, is particularly unique to coal mining areas, and in Pittsburgh in particular. And the fact that, for the most part, all these little villages around here are gone. If you try and find Broughton, I don't even know that there's a single building that exists. The little village of Curry, once again, they're all Horning. The village of Horning, I drove through about 20 years ago. It was four wooden shacks back then. All of these villages are usually a footnote in a textbook, maybe a street sign. There's still a Fairhaven street sign down on Provost Road. It's called both Provost and Fairhaven. But this was a singularly unique developmental method for neighborhoods in this area. And one of the most important ones was Fairhaven. And this was the last building, the last non-residential building that survives. And it is important that this stay around as a tribute to all of those people who paid 3 cents a week out of their very poor wages. And the Pittsburgh Historic Commission agreed. And so now we have historic status from the city of Pittsburgh. It doesn't mean that we're not immune to PennDOT. For those, this is in 2014, PennDOT is building a huge interchange. They tore down the second oldest building in Fairhaven, which was Old Kukul's Tavern. And now Fairhaven, this church really is the last one. It was just Kukul's and us for a long time. But everything is gone for this interchange. Like I said, there are some residences up on the original Fairhaven Village that predate this. Most of them were converted into residences from farms, from stables and from barns. But that was the important thing. So now if PennDOT wants to claim eminent domain over this property, they will need to go to the Pittsburgh Historic Commission and have a vote, and then go to the City Planning Commission and have a vote, and then go to City Council and have a vote, and then go to the mayor and get his approval, which is what the church had to do for all these things. There was at least seven different meetings testifying regarding the church and its importance to the community. We're still a very big community-based organization, but this building continues to be, as it was in 1907, a center for life. The community has expanded enormously. We're surrounded by concrete, but it is still an important touchstone for many, many people here. This church was dedicated December 7th, to be exact, and there was clearly a concerted effort to increase the membership by approaching German immigrants. That's when most of my family came to be members of this church. I had family members who were who joined earlier, but the vast majority joined in 1907. My grandmother was here. She was here for the dedication, and she's the person who told me about the church, and she gave me some artifacts, which are now part of the archives. And the German folks who came to this church almost uniformly belonged to the German United Evangelical Church of Christ, which was called the Rooster Church in local parlance. And it was located on 10th and Frederick Street on the south side. And so probably for most people, attending church was at least residence here in Fairhaven, maybe three times a year. But now that there was a church directly below where they lived, they were able to attend church on a regular basis. This building and the people who belong to it became the hub of the community in a literal and figurative way. This building was the nicest building. It's actually the last surviving building, non-commercial, from the village. Everything else comes after this. Mr. Hayes owned a house on Jacob Street, very nice, very well-appointed house. And he was a member here, as well as Mr. Horning and Mr. Horning's wife, Cordelia Long Horning. What I think is fascinating is the juxtaposition of who was attending this church, very small church. We're talking in 1900, probably 50 members. That's exactly what it is, 50 members. We have men of great affluence and their employees who are paid very poorly, 9 cents for every ton of coal that they mined. And it was a very dangerous job, water leakage. I've had three family members killed in coal mine accidents in the last 90 years of my life, or last 90 years of my family's history. It's very dangerous, but they attended church here together. I don't know what the level of friendliness was or the level of animosity, but given the extreme poverty of this community and given the fact that these miners could not afford to buy the coal they mined, I find it a little humbling and inspiring that they were able to attend the church with the men that they had to feel at some level ambivalent about. In 1907, Fairhaven was still very epidemic prone, and there's a record in the church logs that, and I don't remember the date, September 7th, 1892, where the church closed down for a funeral. It would close down for bad weather. And during epidemics, it would close down too. And this happened a lot. We see a lot of, as I said earlier, children dying of cholera, diphtheria, My grandmother was one of 12 children, only six of whom survived to adulthood. Coming from that kind of an era where death was so prevalent and commonplace, this church had to have served as a huge kind of oasis and an inspiration for hope and that things could be better. And I have no doubt that it enhanced the quality of their lives in many, many ways. The Horing family was always great patrons of religion, and in a sidebar, the old St. Norbert's Church was an old barn building. People in St. Norbert's, the Catholic Church right behind us, they stopped meeting in there in 1919, but they still held school there. It was the old Horning barn. And in photographs, it looks like an old ramshackle barn. And I have friends who attended the school because it didn't close until the 1960s. The membership of the church continued to increase. And in the 1940s, we see the membership topping out at around 400. Today, the membership on paper is about 155. Active members are about 61 members, but very, very active community. Most of the windows, which we'll talk about later, were done through fundraising drives by youth groups or the ladies groups or the Sunday school. When this church was dedicated in 1907, the demographics of the community are a little harder to gauge. But in 1880, when there was 360 plus members of the Fairhaven who lived in the community, over 70% were German, about 10% Welsh, and there was a couple families that were native born to this area. There is a lot of oral history that talks about the origins of the Castle Shannon Railroad, and much too lengthy to go into, but suffice to say that the railroad, which Jacob Hayes owned in order to transfer his coal from here to the Monongahela River, he owned most of the mines all along Library Road, all the way into Castle Shannon. Part of the restrictions placed on him by the legislature was that if he was going to have a freight train service, he had to have passengers as well. And so we see today the train tracks for the trains that still run by here, but also the tracks that the buses take was a part of the passenger truck route. Most of the little villages where they were stopped, like Elwyn, it's gone. There's an Elwyn Street right near Neely Road. That was the Elwyn stop, but there was an Elwyn community and an Elwyn coal mine. Many, many mines along here. In 1939, a city building inspector came along for whatever reason. I don't know what prompted him, but he noticed that the church building, this church building, had a tilt to the port, as he studied in quotes. This is part of our written history. I don't know how accurate it is. The city no longer has their old records from building condemnations. I tried to find it, but to no avail. And he came in and did an inspection. And certainly the foundation, due to the fact that there was no footer dug, no concrete to put the rubble stone on, the many floods that had taken place, the church was condemned. He also said that he didn't know what was keeping the roof on. The roof was slate, very, very heavy, as I'm sure most people know. And the city also demanded that the church improve on sanitary things. That's when the bathroom was added, the restrooms. Before then, we had an outhouse in the parking lot. They wanted heat put in. The gas stoves weren't enough. The building was lit by coal, not coal, by gas lights. And if you go along the walls, this isn't the original exterior of the walls, but we do see pipes, which I can show you where the furnaces were, and underneath this cellulose that they put on in 1939, the original gas outlets for the gas lights. During the 14 months that it took to meet the standards demanded by the city, the church congregation met downstairs in the community room, and many things were done. The kitchen was added in the back. There had been a fireplace in the community room where people cooked on the fireplace. Now there was an actual kitchen where they had stoves, and you can see the hot water pipes that run along for the radiator heats. It cost about $10,000, and the church membership paid it off in 1946. And I forget the exact date, but one of our more famous pastors was the pastor here, and they had a burning of the mortgage service, which my grandmother was at it, my father, and $10,000 in 1939 and 1946, still a considerable amount of money. But the women's group raised it, and the youth groups raised money. Very, very active fundraisers. One of the other things that they did during that 1939 renovation was to cover up the original plaster. The original plaster was horsehair plaster and on lathe. One thing I did want to say too is we had talked about, I had talked about the quatrefoil windows. The quatrefoil windows were never seen from inside the church. A lot of repainting was done, refinishing of floors. Not much value placed on saving old stuff. These pews were replaced in 1971. We got a new organ in 1946. The old pump organ was thrown away. The bell tower, I haven't talked about the bell. So this is the room from which the church bell was rung. It has been used for storage for many years. It was an office for the minister for a while. It was a nursery for a while. The board has given me leeway to restore this in whatever way I seem fit. The church bell sat right above this ceiling, and the pulley is still up there, and it had a brass pulley, and the rope came down, and it was right about here, which is where Mr. Lewis would ring it. I don't know where I assume the pump organ had something back here too, but I'm not positive. But found parts of the rope, and the hole was still in the ceiling if you go up there, which I have done several times. An important integral piece to the community history, it was the timepiece. You know, men had their pocket watches, but this, everybody knew when it was 8:45 and 10:15.
So,
since 1907, the church interior has changed dramatically. It was originally all dark wood. It was all this color here. This is the only probably original piece of structural stuff that you can see. Everything was this color, even the pews. The floors are original too, but they're covered over with carpeting. I had thought that the window went all the way up further so we could see the quatrefoil windows, but that's not the case. There's actually a catwalk that goes across here for maintenance, and that's where the pieces of the quatrefoil window are still laying up there. You see these metal pillars, metal posts right here. This was installed in 1939 when the city condemned the church. And their fear was that the ceilings, the walls were not strong enough to support the roof. These tension bars were put in four directions to maintain the roof's integrity. As I said, all the original fixtures here are gone. The original lectern, the original organ, original pews. The only thing is just this banister, and No one's going to take it out, or I'll have a, be very unhappy. I guess a word about Mr. Horning. He was born the year the Civil War ended, and his parents were John and Cordelia Long Horning. He had he was married twice. His wife, Ada Horning, died, you know, before their child was born, and then he married 2 years later to his deceased wife's cousin, also from Ottumwa, Iowa, Marie, and their maiden name was Messinger. And Mrs. Messinger, or Miss Messinger, had two additional children for Mr. Horning. And she died in 1952. Cannot find a photograph of her either. I have one of Mr. Horning, but not, it's ironic, the person who lived into the 50s is the one I don't have a photo of. But, and I get, maybe this is a good thing to do too. This is a painting that someone did of the church. And I keep talking about quatrefoil windows. And what are they? These are the quatrefoil windows. This was all glass, and it might look like a four-leaf clover to some, but it really isn't. It's about, it's the four, quatra, is symbolic of Father, Son, Holy Ghost, and the Lamb.
That's how the bell tower looks.
Yes, how the bell tower looked. It's very similar to what it looks like now. We have a cross on it up there now, but that's what the original structure looked like. And these quatrefoil windows, just beautiful. You can see the pediments here, are the and how the steps, I mean, they have four here. There's only two. But this was all farmland. And I mean, it's pretty amazing how, you know, the city has grown up to meet the church and surrounded it. The coal stoves, there was a coal stove here to heat the sanctuary, and one there, and one more back there, and one over here.
Where the radiators.
Yeah, where the radiators are. And there were chimneys which ventilated them. The chimneys, at least the part that was above the roof line, were dismantled. I don't know. I believe they're still in existence under the roof, but above the roof line, they're diminished. The gas lights, not kerosene, the gas lights were here, there. I mean, very dark, very dark. And with the dark wood, must have been a very, very hard place to see. Windows are attributed, once again, no documentation at all, to the Rudy Brothers studio. And the Rudy Brothers were very famous stained glass designers. Their studio was in East Liberty. And many of the artisans who worked there went on to work at Tiffany's in Boston. Many famous homes, many churches have Rudy Brothers windows. The Mellons mausoleums have them. The mausoleums for the Mellon family also have Rudy Brother windows. This window is, this is the Hannah Hibbs window. Very small, very simple, probably in keeping with the kind of person that she was. She was listed as the first member of the church for many, many years when she was on the roster. She, as I said, she got the property donated for this church. She cleaned the church. Was quite elderly when she died for her time period. She was 82 when she died. This is the Isabel Fulton window. And most of our windows have hand-painted paintings in the middle of them. This is of a chalice and wheat, reminding us of God's bounty in the wheat. And chalice, Jesus' blood, which was sacrificed for us. Over here, we have the Ada Horning window. Ada Horning was born in Ottumwa, Iowa, married to Orlando Horning. And, you know, Horning was a very wealthy man. He owned all this land from as far as you can see back towards St. Norbert. But the symbol here in the window is of wheat. Once again, a reminder of God's bounty. If you look at this window, this is also his priority one damage. Very cracked, very, very cracked. Ada Horning, for all of her fundraising, like Isabel Fulton, didn't live to see the church dedicated. Isabel Fulton died in January of 1907. Ada Horning died a week before the church's dedication. She died of, she was 8 months pregnant and died of a stroke at the age of 39. And this is the Lady's Aid window. This window was restored this year. Money was given by the Pittsburgh Historic Landmark Foundation. Many donors contributed as well. The original window was donated by the Lady's Aid Society, which is, there's always been a very active women's group in the church. The Lady's Aid Society no longer exists. It's now the Methodist Women's Society. My grandmother, my mother, my sister all belong to that. And a new addition in our tributes is to Mr. Twigger. His descendants still attend the church also. He became a member in 1893. And the family gave a sizable contribution. And we, in return, we agreed to dedicate this panel of the window in Mr. Twigger's memory. The cross with the crown, very, very obvious. Jesus is Lord of Lords, King of Kings. He reigneth. And the beautiful, beautiful details of the window, which until this year have not really been able to be appreciated. I mean, it was only put in a month ago. I'm looking at it now. The red is stunning. The red is stunning. The Christian Endeavor window. The Christian Endeavor Society no longer exists. It was a youth group up through the 1930s and disbanded then. This window too has priority one damage. I don't know if you can see it, but the window is bowing out along those side, like triangular, going up towards the point. They're bowing out. The painting itself is very hard to make out. It's a lamb, because the metaphor in the Bible is that, you know, we are the sheep and Jesus is the shepherd. And he takes care of his flock. This window was redone 2 years ago, and it's dedicated to Mr. Evans, who was married to one of my cousins, and he was the volunteer choir director for 60 years. The painting is of lilies, which is a flower of Easter, rebirth, Jesus coming back from the dead, and. The restoration of that hand-painted glass is stunning. This is our centerpiece window, and the one that's probably the most familiar to everybody. This window was clearly always meant to be dedicated to the Horning family, because as when we had someone come in to give us an estimate, the painting of Jesus and the scene there is unlike the other ones, which that painting is exposed, this one is double-paned glass. So clearly, this was a higher priority window, and the Hornings wanted to dedicate it to them because it was a lot more expense involved. This window probably cost, in 1907, about $3,000. I don't know what it would cost now, but the damage around the outside that's being supported is also priority one damage. You can see what's going to happen to this window over here soon is when the window is bowing, it's just like bending in half almost. That's what's happening right here. And pretty soon, this is going to crack and this is going to crack. You can see replacement glass, which was done over the years. But this is the churches. I mean, this is the window that people see every day because it's on Sawmill Run Boulevard. This window also, major, major damage. The shield is the focal point here, and symbolizing that those who believe are protected. What I call the Sunday school window, and this has an interesting story to it. We don't really know what happened, but there was a medallion there, obviously, with some Methodist symbol on it, and it was broken. And once again, we don't even know when it was broken. My guess would probably be in the 1930s. And there's no documentation to what was on it. And as a historian, as someone who wants to restore the windows, it's very frustrating. The earliest picture we have of this young lady's Sunday school group shows many people wearing a heart with an M on it for Methodist. And I'm really thinking that maybe that, because this was, that picture was taken about 5 years before the church was built. So I'm thinking that perhaps that's what the symbol is. But I mean, obviously I would much prefer to have what was there, even if I didn't like it. But that piece got broken. We don't know how, we don't know when, but it was built out. I mean, it does, not very well done. I mean, the whole pane, it just sticks out. But this one is not as bad damage-wise as the other windows. And actually, we have someone who is going to donate a significant amount of money for this window and this window, and have them dedicated to her grandparents and her parents. The two windows here are probably the most damaged windows of all. This one is the anchor, a symbol reminding us that Jesus is the anchor for those who believe, and the anchor will not let us stray off our path. Once again, the dove, Jesus is the Prince of Peace, and the dove is bringing peace and new life, rebirth with a twig after the flood. One of the things that has really proven to be difficult is to acquire artifacts from very early in the church's history. We have a photograph of the Young Ladies Sunday School group at the Fairhaven Church on Glenberry Street, taken 1900. We don't have any of their photographs until 1927. We have a 1925 bulletin. Nothing else really exists. I have an artifact, a paperweight from the church's dedication. Everything is gone. And one of the things that I have very much wanted to been able to document more directly is the church bell. As I said earlier, the bell, in addition to the windows, was donated by Cordelia Long Horning. And the bell served to warn people about mine collapses, fire. There was a huge fire here in Fairhaven regularly. I mean, the buildings were all wood, so, and lighting with coal. The bell would be rung in cases of celebration, the end of World War I. But we have no pictures of that bell. In 1957, the bell tower, the cupola, the top piece of the tower, was deemed to be structurally dangerous. So it was dismantled, and the bell was put in the front yard on display, and it stayed there from 1957 to 1971, when it was stolen. Not a surprising thing. Very sad, but what's even more surprising is that they have absolutely no photographs of it in the front yard of the church. The impact of history on this church is, I think, important to put into context. In 1944, the population of the membership of the church was about 360. And at that point, in 1944, there were at least 75 men and women from this church who were involved in World War II in combat. Six of our members died. Three of them were my father's cousins. But the enormous amount, we're talking an enormous amount of resources. Over a quarter of the church's population was serving the United States in fighting Nazi Germany in Japan. The impact of that was enormous. Raising money became very difficult. Being that our church is maintained by volunteers, the church wasn't as well appointed as it needed to be. It created a huge impact. In 1907, if you looked across the street, Sawmill Run would have been a buggy path, you know, probably no more than 5 feet wide. It was dirt. There were four buildings on the other side. There was the Imhoff blacksmith, Rinaldo groceries, and a feed store. Across Glenberry, there was Mr. Provost owned a mill where you could grind flour. And on the far side of 88, there was Kunkel's Tavern, later called Hillview, now gone, and a couple of houses. A boarding house called Rogerson's was where the Rite Aid is right now. And of course, the Hornings had a house two doors down from here. But you didn't see much. And the natural gas here, you know, makes the water taste funny. When my father was a boy, and he lived up on Fairhaven Hill on top of the mine, it was not unusual for mine collapses to drop people's floors 10 feet. Very common, very, very common. The founder of the church, Robert Perry, have looked for him for many years, many years. I finally found a great-grandson of his, whose name is, his middle name is Robert, first, last name is Perry, I forget his first name, lives in Plum, and the great-grandson of Mr. Perry in his 80s. He really didn't know that his great-grandfather was a founder of a church or anything like that, but part of the database and the donor set that I am trying to collect are people like Dr. Conley, the great-grandson of Ada Horning, and Mr. Perry, people who have a historic interest in the survival and maintenance of the church, whose ancestors were critical pieces in keeping the church alive. And certainly the Twigger family who donated money for the window, the lady who's donating money for this window, they are, you know, their ancestors, this was the focal point of their lives, and the goal was to build a funding base for projects like this, because the church, I mean, we don't have any money. We don't. Like I said, we run a deficit every year, so finding people to support us is going to be an ongoing goal indefinitely. Most of the ministers who came here in the early years, as I said, were itinerant, and they didn't stay very long, 1 or 2 years tops, some even less. They had to ride on horseback. One of them was Reverend West, and I think that the horseback ride from here to Crafton was just too much for him, and he quit within 3 months. But most, very few ministers stayed longer than that. The minister who was here for the dedication and building of this building, Reverend Sanders, stayed 7 years. One of the longest serving pastors ever for this church was Reverend Mary Burton. She came here in 1981 and left in 2001. And it was under her guidance that the addition onto the church was built, which was called Burton Hall. And the steeple was rebuilt, the cupola was built on top of the steeple, on top of the church was redone. A new roof. She was very energetic and became a very, very major part of the history of the church, more so than most ministers, because she was here for so long. We intend and we will continue to be an integral member of the Carrick and Overbrook community. We're here to serve people, regardless of what their needs are. We know that you know, the Bible and God served as a great source of comfort for them and an inspiration for them. That is something that they could have anytime, but they also had a community where these things were valued. And the community that valued the Word of God, that valued the role of God in our lives, the sure and certain knowledge of life after death is what this church brought to these people. And I guess another way to say it is they brought them hope. The hope that their lives would be better than their parents. The hope that they'd live to be adults. The hope that they could be happy. And I think that is the most critical piece of this church's legacy, is giving that to very, very, very poor people. And a huge community arose from that, of which I am one of several five-generation members in this church. And it continues to impact me and how I live, how my family lives, and the community of this church. It continues to do that for the whole community and for us specifically.